What's up, guys? How are you? Maribon, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks a lot for having me on, man.
Oh, yeah. You know I like having you on.
Oh, yeah. I know that.
And you know why.
Because you get to torture me with weird songs.
Not weird songs. Classic songs that like 90% of everybody walking the planet know, but somehow you don't know them.
Okay. We'll go with that spin.
Okay, guys, so we're going to be talking about the art of tennis, but first, we have to quiz Maribon. It's kind of becoming a tradition on his musical knowledge. Now, again, it could be like a slap to him or a slap to me. It's like this kind of showing me how old I'm getting because like these songs are classic, okay? And somehow he doesn't know them. He didn't know a Prince song, Let's Go Crazy. He didn't know Billy Joel's Pressure. He didn't know the Chicago Bulls theme song. So he didn't know Jack and Diane by John Cougar or John Cougar Mellencamp. So this one, though, I think is a softball, Maribon. Are you ready?
Oh, yeah, I'm ready.
Okay, here we go.
Ready to Google.
Listen up. I got my first real six string. Boy, it at the five and done. Played it as a play. Do you know that?
I have heard it many times.
What is it?
Summer of 69.
Oh my god, he did it!
Yeah. I'm so lucky that the name is in the lyrics, which I guess is most songs.
Congratulations, Maribon.
Thank you.
You did it.
1 out of 10. Vamos.
I was hoping Michael said, be careful with him. Summer of 69. Yeah. Great classic song. Double bonus now. Do you know who sang it?
No.
Brian Adams. Brian
Adams. Oh, wow.
Marcel Tennis. It's good to see everybody on. Super excited. We already have 116 people on. They must like these live streams.
Yeah, I think they do. We always get really good feedback, which I put in the email. So I figured, we both figured why not do another one, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Sunday night party, baby.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm really excited, Pete, to have you on because I know a lot of people obviously struggle with technique and whether or not you have good or bad technique. I think it's really nice to really learn, you know, the proper way to go about developing it. And, you know, of course, it's not everything, but there's a lot of us who really aspire to have really solid, optimal technique. And that's what Pete is going to show us today. And I'll prod him with as many questions as I can. And I'm really excited to look forward and to learn from a great coach like Pete on technique.
Very cool. Yeah. Thank you, Maribon. So today's topic is called the art of tennis. And the reason why I decided to call it the art of tennis is because when you see tennis played at a very high level, it's very artistic. It's very pretty to watch. If you watch, I'm just going to share my screen here. And if you watch Federer hit a shot, almost any shot he hits, he does something what I call in your face form. So we're going to bring this up. Let me know when you can see it, Maribon.
Right now it's us two.
Okay. Can you see?
Okay, I see your screen. Yeah.
Okay, cool. So we're going to come over here to the great Roger Federer. And you can see like pretty much any frame we find him in, you know, look at it, look at how still the head is. Look at how he's using his offhand. This looks, you don't have to know much about tennis, right? You just look at these poses and you know that this is a good tennis player. You know that he's got what I call in your face form. Okay. Look at that. They all look good, right? I mean,
beautiful.
You don't have to like watch him hit a ball to know who is that guy. He looks like he's pretty good. It's kind of interesting how someone doesn't even have to hit a ball to like go, wow, they look pretty good. I'm going to, and the thing is you don't have to be a professional to have in your face form right here. This is Victor Pham. I started coaching him when he was about 6 or 7.
Nice.
And I knew right away, this guy played for Columbia. He's been, I'll read some of his credentials when we scroll down, but one thing that why do I bring him up is I remember him being 6, 7, 8 years old. And every time that we were picking up balls and things like that, he was always working on his form, you know, without a tennis ball. And he developed what I call in your face form. You don't have to really watch. watch him play to start to go, that guy looks good. Like, who is he? And, you know, because he's done his work on the art of tennis. And right here, he's honored as Ivy League Player of the Year for the second consecutive season. And I knew when he was, like, I knew the first time he came on the court, just based off the way that he approached the game, that he was going to become a great player and master his art and be able to, you know, be an artist on the court, for not even lack of a better word, for a very accurate saying. So going to remove this from the screen. And so what do you have to say about that, Maribon?
Yeah, beautiful technique that you've displayed. And I wanted to ask you a follow-up question about your student. You know, you mentioned that you could tell that he would be a great player. Like, what types of attributes were those that that led you to that conclusion?
Well, one thing that's interesting, we're gonna talk a lot about it tonight. I'm going to get into more detail. But I noticed with my own habits that I developed, you know, I was a pretty good junior player, state champion, nationally ranked. And I was always working on my game off the court. But it wasn't like I was like, okay, I've got to work on my game off the court. It's like you couldn't stop me. You could not stop me from doing it. It was like almost, you know, kind of like Rafa, OCD, to where every time I was walking around, I was working on, because I really enjoyed, besides winning, I loved all the artistic movements of tennis. Like, I wanted to look perfect. I wanted to have picture perfect form. So, you know, I'd always be walking around the house and practicing and I'm sure you were probably the same way. Were you doing that too?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Just imagining, you know, the best players and then just like copying their technique. Yeah. I think a lot of us do that.
Yeah. And what I want everybody here to understand is, like, it's not too late. You don't have to be a professional. I remember starting a beginner class. Is like, there's certain things as a coach you remember. I remember starting a beginner class and I had a group of players and I was showing them the technique. I was just walking them through the technique. And most of the players just kind of looking at me or whatever. And they were engaged a little bit, but then I saw this one woman to where she was like locked in, like her eyes were locked in, almost like when you play fetch with a dog, like she just had that much attention to every move and she was studying it. And then I saw her practicing it. And then, you know, all these players who have been playing, she got into the group lessons, then she started taking private lessons. All these people who have been playing around the club for years would ask me, and she was not even, she probably couldn't even be a 3-0 at that point. But before she was even like a 3-0 player, everybody was asking, like, who is she? Who is that woman that you've been teaching? Because she was developing right off the bat in your face form. Where most people who play out there, who play tennis, you know, most people who play tennis are playing recreational tennis, and most people do not have that in your face form. They have not developed that. And I'm going to talk about why that doesn't happen for a lot of people out there.
Sweet, Pete. Sweet. Well, I mean, I'm just really excited for you to get into it. I guess maybe as a preface, unless this ruins your whole presentation, I mean, what's like one... Okay, we'll just go with it. What's the first big reason why we develop really bad technique, or okay, you know, not optimal technique? Yeah.
So here's my theory, and it's been, and I've thought this for years, and then within the last, since the pandemic has hit us, it's like proven what I have been saying and preaching for years, and it's been such a strong feeling that I've developed over the last like 60 days to where I'm like, I have to do it this way all the time now. Like, even when the pandemic goes away, this is the way that we're going to practice a lot. Okay. Together, not to say that we're not going to be hitting balls, but I think 90% of sports get it wrong. When you first go to a tennis court, okay, you want to play tennis. So your first day at tennis, especially let's say you go out there with a friend, right? Who here has, and I'm going to keep talking, but I want you to write it down. My question here as I keep continue to talk is, who here, their first tennis experience was going out with a friend with some beginner rackets and a tennis ball? And how well did it go? Like, how well did your first time on a tennis court go? Maribon, what about you? What was your first experience with tennis?
It was fun. It was going on the court with my dad. He brought me on the court. I can't say how great my technique was. I'm pretty sure my backhand technique wasn't that great. Forehand was okay. But yeah, first time with a friend for sure, not a coach.
And did you rally? Did you use a regular ball? Like, what was going on there?
Yeah, so we use a regular ball. The rackets, I know they were like wooden rackets. I'm not sure how long they were, but yeah, just kind of hitting around whatever I could hit and return.
So you and your dad were trying to rally together.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So see, this is a big mistake that most people make in tennis. And I'm going to talk about other sports. And I'm going to talk about my favorite sport that I think gets it right, even though I never done it, but I've always studied, I've always watched it go, they've got it right. Okay. So Maribon went on the court and he's rallying with his dad. Now, obviously he worked out these techniques. He's a very good player, but I bet you his first time out off the gate, the first ball he's hit, he's already developing bad habits, because you go out with a racket, you go out there with a regular tennis ball, and I don't care if you're a kid or an adult, most of the time the ball, especially if you're playing with somebody else who's not that good, you know, the ball is bouncing and your lots of rallies look like this when you start hitting, okay? Because very few balls are right in your sweet spots where you can even develop a nice stroke. And you don't even know what a nice stroke is when you first go out, unless you're starting right off the bat with a teaching pro who's most likely showing you the technique and then feeding you some balls underhand just to get the rhythm of it, or maybe rallying with a low compression ball, which there's a shot right there. Let's see, I start with eight, but not sure I started with a lesson or my dad first. What are some other things? Sounds more like not well. My Elish Dossi metal racket a long time ago.
I like Paul's comment. My tennis moves are an art form comedy.
An art form comedy. So this is the battle that most of us struggle with. You go out to the court, you're there with a tennis ball, you're trying to rally with somebody, the ball's bouncing really high, and right off the bat, you're ingraining bad habits. So that's why most tennis players are between a 3-0 and a 4-0, right? I mean, if you're a 4-5 at your club or above, even a high 4-0 or above, you're one of the players that everybody kind of looks to and goes, wow, they're pretty good. You know, like you can hear the cracking of the ball. It sounds different. And then all of a sudden you watch them hit and you're like, that looks pretty good. Like, I want to play like that. So, I mean, you don't need to be Roger Federer to develop in your face form, but you do need to develop good fundamentals. And I think it's easier to accomplish the way I'm going to explain it tonight. What do you say about that, Maribon?
Yeah, I think it's going to be exciting. And yeah, it's really tough when you develop bad habits from the outset. And, you know, obviously we can't blame you, you know, whatever circumstances that you began to play tennis much better than not being introduced to the game. And so thanks to whoever introduced you, of course. But yeah, if you don't do it properly, I guess it's going to take time to reverse those bad habits. And so the sooner you can start learning how to produce proper technique and develop it, the better. So really looking forward to it, Pete.
Yeah, cool. So here's the thing. Let's think about most sports. I think most sports get it wrong. I'm just going to come right out and say it. Most sports get it wrong if you want to teach somebody to be an artist, right? Most teaching is developed to make mediocrity prevalent within the game. I'm just going to put it like that. If you go and you go to a basketball court and you watch a bunch of kids play, like has any of your kids ever played, you know, little league rec basketball? You know, what does it look like? I've coached kids. I've gone to my nephew's games, and what it is a big cluster. They're all together banging into each other. They shoot like this, right? Because they have to. Even the kids who start off with a smaller ball on a lower hoop. Okay. The first thing that they're going to start to do, first of all, everybody, especially now that the 3-point play is, the kids wants to shoot as far as he can away. So he's going to go back. He's going to take both hands, he or she, he's going to take both hands and throw it at the basket. That's what they're going to do. Their first move certainly not going to look like this. So right away, their first time they shoot a ball, they've developed bad habits. If you look at soccer, And I used to play soccer as a kid. I was terrible at soccer. But I remember soccer, you know, you did some drills, but then it's like, okay, now let's play. And then the kids are all together banging into each other. It's a big club. And you're basically kicking at each other's knees. That's what I remember from Little League soccer. Did you ever play soccer, Maribon, or no?
Just at school, yeah, but not too much.
Yeah. But this is what it looks like, okay? Now, here's the big thing. This is the one sport that gets it, in my mind, 100% right because of the nature of the game. I think this is why it is. Is karate gets it right. If you go to and you watch a karate class, the instructors are always teaching in progressions. You are listening a lot. You are watching a lot. And then you are working on the moves. You know, can you imagine if a mom or a dad dropped their kid off for their first karate lesson and you walk in, you see all these kids who have no technique fighting each other?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's what we do by rallying, right? Like all of a sudden we just launch into it, right?
Yeah, we just launch into it.
Yeah.
But it's okay because we're not going to get hurt physically. So that's why we do it. Mm-hmm. But it's not okay because if you want to be as good as you can be, you're developing bad technique right off the bat. Like, I don't care who you are. I don't care what good an athlete you are. Some people are able to sustain better technique than others, but everybody's starting off with bad habits if you're just going out there and trying to survive and rally. And so karate, they teach you the moves. They make sure you have really good technique before you're allowed to even hit anything and before you're allowed to hit anyone. And that takes even longer. And I'm doing this online summer camps with Pete, which is pretty cool. And I was talking to a karate instructor and I was basically just making sure that I was right with what I was saying. He's like, yeah, you're 100% right. We'd never let kids come in and start hitting each other and
being crazy.
Develop really good technique. We teach them all the moves and make sure their technique is perfect or fundamentally sound before we even think about introducing the idea of fighting. Yeah. That's a big part of it. Any questions on that, Maribon?
Yeah. I mean, what would you say to parents perhaps, or anyone else who, you know, wants to help their kid out and like, you know, the kid wants to play and that's it. Like, would you just advise that they go either straight to a tennis instructor or like themselves educate about the game and then start doing drop feeding and teaching technique?
Yeah, so it's a balancing act, especially here in the United States. You know, one story I wanted to tell, I went to a USPTA conference. I wish I could remember this guy's name because as soon as I started listening to him, he was just so mesmerizing. And he played on the pro tour. And he said that the club that he grew up at, guys, you're not going to believe this. The club that he grew up at, he said, first of all, we could all play tennis. Everybody I grew up with, we could all play tennis. Not everybody went pro, but he said we all looked good. We all learned the art of tennis. They were artists on the court. They all looked good. They all had great fundamentals. When they hit the ball cracked off the racket. When you watch them hit, it's in your face form. If you're going to take a picture of them, it looks good. This is what I'm talking about. And he said that they did not hit a tennis ball for the first 6 months. That actually they had 3 months of lectures. Can you imagine kids listening to 3 months of lectures today with tennis? But that's what they did. They had to listen and watch and listen and watch. And then they were allowed to start shadow swinging. And then they introduced the tennis ball. Complete opposite of what we do. We start batting the ball around, figuring, and then we start going, holy crap, this game's hard. I better go get some lessons. So you go to lessons with like a boatload of bad habits and you go, here, teach me. Like that's basically how we learn tennis, especially people who grow up as adults. Cause a lot of people on this call did not grow up playing junior tennis where they focus more on the fundamentals. It's like you like tennis, you pick it up, you kind of maybe start playing on your own. You go to a club, they start running clinics, they start feeding two balls to you, hit, then you play some games at the end and you go home. This is what most people do.
Yeah, it really takes a lot of discipline and planning because I know it's very tempting for everybody to just leap in. Fortunately, there's certain sports like you mentioned, like karate, for example, that that preach that discipline that, no, you're going to learn first the moves properly and the technique before you get into it. But especially with courts being, you know, very accessible for a lot of us, at least, we just like to go out there and launch into it. But you really need to have that discipline to put in many, many reps of shadow swings are the best way to start it off. And then to go from there, just like you illustrated, Pete.
Yeah. And so, you know, this is what I'm so excited about is I've been doing challenges to where we are doing a lot of technique work where people can send in their videos and I analyze them and I show them what they're doing right and what they're doing wrong. And it's a process too. It takes time to develop good form and good habits, especially if you have some bad habits. And one of the things that separates somebody who excels, you know, there have been many players that I have coached or I've watched or I've met to where they've been stuck at a 3-5 for 10, 15 years. And then finally they decide, damn it, I'm going to learn a continental grip. I don't care. I'm going to learn it. I'm going to study it. I'm going to take my time with it. I'm going to do that. I'm going to learn the fundamentals and really get them down and really study myself. And then, boom, they take off. They don't take off right away, but at some point they take off. Something, you know, at some point, all of a sudden, everything starts to click. It doesn't click in the beginning, but at some point it starts to click. And then that's where the magic happens. And so the first challenge I did was a serve challenge. And everybody did pretty well on that. But they went out and they were hitting serves because we could still play tennis. The second challenge we did was a forehand challenge. Again, everybody did well, but most people were out on the court hitting. So we got some really good results, but they could have been better results. Then we've done a 30-day tennis technique and fitness challenge where most people had no tennis courts. And some people even told me, because some people didn't sign up and I said, why? Some people even told me I didn't sign up because I don't have a tennis court to go to. Like thinking I can't improve unless I go to a tennis court. And so those people thinking is dead wrong. Okay. That's where you keep your bad habits going. Unless you're really,
it is
being aware. That's why you go out year after year and you're like, why don't I change? I play so much tennis. Why isn't anything changing?
Yeah. Yeah. It's brutal, Pete. Cause, you know, there's always, again, people like they might take a lesson or two, but then they have like a USTA match the next day or whatever, or they have a tournament, and then you just want to win so badly, and then you revert to that old technique. And there are, I would say there's a very few people that can actually be disciplined enough to stick with the new technique, knowing that it's not there yet and that they can lose and they're still sticking with it. But I think for the most part, you really, it's much better to put yourself in an environment where you can practice your proper technique first, even if that means not playing competitively for a little while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Maribon, what we're doing is we're giving away 3 days of where you can actually try this new thing for free, because
it's awesome.
It puts a lot of work on me. It's countless hours. Okay. I'm going to show you guys here in a second what I'm going through, but I want to do it because I really want to help people. You know, so that's why I'm offering three free days. I mean, I get up in the morning, I'm just going through a laundry list of videos, but the results are amazing. And I'm going to show you one right now. This one lady that I'm going to show you here in a second, hopefully the video will play nice. Maribon can let me know if it's not. She started sending me videos of her matches, and in matches, she is afraid. She doesn't even know. She serves like this. She does not know how to hit a continental grip. Okay. So before the pandemic, she's playing she's on like 3 or 4 different league teams. And of course you want to win. She's competitive. This lady is competitive. So when I watch her play matches, she's here serving just like that. Can you see that in the frame, Maribon?
Yes.
This is how she's serving. This is how she's serving, guys. Literally, no exaggeration. She's powder puffing the ball in there. Okay. She's a good athlete, so she can fire the first one in the frying pan grip flat serve. Sometimes she can scoot one in there a pretty good pace. The second one's always a lollipop moon ball. Okay. But she is she's so damn aggressive with the wanting to learn to play the right way. And ever since that this quarantine's been going on, she's daily doing shadow swings, and now she's serving in her backyard. Okay. So I just want to, because I'm just so proud of my students, I want to show you what she's accomplished. Now, is it perfect? No. Does she still have a way to go? Yes. Okay. It's not about trying to show you somebody who's perfect and Roger Federer. This is about trying to show you somebody who's in the same boat you are, who's willing to work to improve. So I'm just going to play this. Hopefully you guys can hear it. Let me know if you can't.
Hi, Pete. Mindy here. I'm trying to get my ball toss more in line with my shoulder, ideally, and higher, so I can try to come up on edge more instead of going out towards the ball.
Can you see that, Maribon?
Yeah, I can see her.
Cool.
That's awesome.
Watch this, guys. She's in the continental grip. She's getting there to the secret power source. And
nice.
Look at this nice snap. Watch this one. This one's the best one. See that ball curve?
Nice.
This woman had no idea how to serve.
Wow.
Before the pandemic. Okay. And then but you know, she's not done. I was showing her that her elbow's too high and all that stuff. So I come back and I coach her up.
You are freaking.
So I basically coach her up there. But this is the process. You guys see all these right here? This is what we're doing right now. And you guys get to do this for 3 days for free. Look at all these videos coming through.
It's awesome.
This is what we're doing. And you can see down here, this is the relationship. Boom, boom, boom. We go back. Actually, this is like a new little thread here. It's kind of like works like almost like an Instagram story, but she's got some threads further down where it's like we literally going off the page. Like we're building a relationship. And what I like about the way I'm doing these challenges is it's not like you're done. You know, it's like it's continuing education. Because tennis is a journey. You know, we can tell you that, hey, you buy this one thing and you're done and you're fixed. It's a magic bullet. You can get better. Every time you buy something for your education in tennis, it helps you get better. You should do that. It helps you grow. But, you know, don't think that one particular course is going to solve all your problems. And don't think that even if you sign up for this this next thing we're going to be doing, which is a 14-day tennis terminator challenge, which we'll tell you a little bit more later, don't think that that's going to solve all your problems either. But what will help you get better is if you go on a journey with me and we're going through all these challenges together, because tennis is one big challenge, but we're going through all these challenges together to where now all of a sudden you're watching yourself on video and you're starting to go, holy crap, I didn't even know I looked like that. I cannot believe it. And don't be afraid of the truth. And then, and then you get to send it to me and you're like, oh my gosh, he gave me this drill that I would have never thought to do by myself. Or he pointed out this thing that I didn't even notice I was doing. It's amazing to me how many times people send in a video and they get it wrong. Like to me, it's pretty glaring the things that they need to work on. And sometimes it's more subtle. Some players are more accomplished. I mean, even four or five players are, that's kind of interesting. The four or five players, this one guy, Ed, he's an excellent player, but he appreciated it more than anybody because he likes the art of tennis. And so when I was able to show him little tweaks, his mind was blown. That's the power of this program.
Pete, what are two or three of the biggest technical mistakes that you've seen? Because I mean, first of all, you're a machine for like going through all of these videos. It's amazing. But what are a couple big technical mistakes that you see that are pretty obvious?
Well, and that's what's so great about this is I'm sure a lot of people taking this, going online, they've studied so much online tennis that they could probably write a book on tennis and write a pretty damn good book. Cause a lot of people who are on here tonight, they're obsessed with tennis and they know a hell of a lot about tennis, but when it comes to their own game, they're unaware of a lot of things that they're doing. So I'm sure almost everybody on the call tonight has heard of a unit turn. Write down in the comment section if you've heard of a unit turn. But most people are messing up the unit turn. Like, for example, people are saying they're backhand. I've seen a lot of two-handed backhands. And so This is what most people are doing on their backhand when they bring it back. Boom. You see, what's wrong with this, guys? Tell me a couple of things that's wrong with this. Tell me what am I doing wrong here? Can anybody tell me? Mirabon, let me know when people start to say it. Does anybody know what's wrong with that?
I'm seeing yes, and of course, tell us.
Well, it's a little bit of a delay, so it will come in.
Yeah, that's true.
So let's just wait for a second. Does anybody?
Here we go. We got some not far enough back, open face, two army, no trunk rotation, racket head down, leading with the arms. Any of that?
Exactly. Good job. So this is what a lot of people are doing is they're bringing the racket face. They're bringing the arms too close. They're making the move with their arm. This is an arm dominated move. And my racket face is slightly too open. And the angles of impact on tennis, you might want to write this down, guys. The angles of impact on a tennis ball are brutal. They are unforgiving, especially this is why you can't swing it out in the match. Unless you've got it, as Rick Macy says, unless you've got your technique baked in the way Roger Federer did, the way Victor Pham, that kid I taught when he was a young man, the way he did. Unless you've got your technique baked in, you can't swing out on a ball under pressure. Because if your angle of impact is a little bit off, a hair off, a frog hair off, that ball's going either into the net or into the fence. Okay, so if I bring it back like this, and then by the time I hit, I'm like that, which isn't that bad. That's going into the fence, especially if I got racket head speed. But look, this is still going into the fence. That's not that bad. It's not till I get about here to where all of a sudden it's got a chance to go in. So your angle of impact is key. It cannot be off a bit. Now all of a sudden I start to go like that. Now all of a sudden, guess what? Now it's in the net. You see, so it's super important to get that right. So what I've been telling people, I'll just give you guys a quick lesson. When I'd be talking to my students, let's say Mirabon's my student, he's bringing his arm. I say, Mirabon, it's a pretty good video. It's a good swing. But what I want to see you do is get here, have the racket tip up, have the arm separated from your body. So don't be in too close, be relaxed. And then I want you to get down, right? So use some legs. I'll show you guys a little more.
You can go full screen if you want.
My bate. Yeah, okay. So I'll go full screen here. So what I tell people is to get here and then you start to pivot the feet. See, now look at that. Now what do you start to see? You start to see my legs engage, my glute, right? And look at how you can see my back. See, now I can rip all of that into the ball, okay? Where if I'm just bringing it like this, you can't even see my back. And a lot of people are showing me this on their backhand. So I would say, you know, the unit turn is key. Lots of people on there on the forehand, when they're sending forehands, they'll even go into a nice unit turn. So they'll know to do this. And then they start to swing like this.
Yeah.
They start to swing with their arm. And I've been telling people, look, your unit turn's good, but then you got to go back even more.
Yeah.
Mark Kovacs talks about, he talks about twisting yourself up almost like he calls it like a Coke bottle, like you're twisting a Coke bottle.
Yeah.
You do that with your hips. See, now look, now I'm spring loaded and I'm still holding on to the racket. And then as I start to let go, then I keep the arm engaged. And then look at this. Look how much the body's moved. How much has my racket moved? It hasn't even come forward yet. Where most people, this stays in the station and the arm starts to go. And this actually looks good for a lot of people, right? But that's all arm. It's not this. It's not where you're coming here. And then the last thing to leave the station is the racket. And that's what the pros are doing or really good players at your club are doing. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'm going to come back with Mirabon. Mirabon, well, one thing that's kind of interesting, you know, if you go out for some beers with some tennis coaches, tennis coaches like to have some beer. Okay. And they also love tennis and they love to talk tennis. You get a tennis coach talking about tennis over some beers, they're constantly talking with their hands. They're like, yeah, I was teaching my student how to volley, you know, and you can tell by the way that they are talking with their hands that they have the art of tennis, that they've studied tennis, they've developed the art of tennis. So when they're talking, you know, it actually looks like really good tennis. Where if you start to talk to somebody who like is just started to play, or you tell them that you like tennis, one of the things that they always do, like, man, I want to play some tennis. And they make a fist and they start kind of like swinging, you know, like, classic. I love tennis.
Classic.
You know? And you can tell right away without them striking a ball that they don't know how to play tennis because they have not developed the art of tennis. Would you say, have that ever happened to you?
Oh, all the time. I mean, like I can imagine or recount so many times where people say, oh, you play tennis, and they'll like do this or something. It's pretty funny. But they don't understand, you know, the whole kinetic chain and the importance of loading, you know, and then exploding and, you know, many different techniques that are required to actually play optimal tennis, which is really just using the body more efficiently than just using your arms.
Yeah. So what I'm getting ready to do, and Maribon, you bring out the free link so they can try this for free before they, you sure. know, have to put down their hard earned cash. Okay. Cause I want everybody to see, even if you don't end up doing the 14-day challenge, I want you to see how powerful this is. So you do it at some point. Like if you're going to buy online courses and you don't at least try this, you're missing the boat because you just keep buying videos that are videos that you can learn a lot from. I'm not saying they're not great to watch videos. These actually come with video instructions. So it's just like your favorite courses to where you're going to get videos to watch. If you're somebody who just like, I just like to watch videos. I don't want to send in a video, right? If you're just going to stay like that, that's fine. You're still going to get that. But now you have the ability to just click a button and send me a video. And we'll show you how easy that is too. But this is the 14-day Tennis Terminator Challenge. We're going to start it next Monday. Okay. And it's three courses in one. We're going to do a 7-day backhand challenge. We're going to upgrade your backhand. It's going to be taught one-hander and two-hander. So the two-handers, we're not leaving you out on this. I know I do a lot of one-hand instruction. This is going to include two-hand as well. And these challenges, you can go out on the court and use a ball machine. You know, you can show me rallying with somebody. So if you want to get on the court and show me what you look like on the court playing, you can do that. If you're still in a part of the state or you don't feel comfortable going to a court, I'm telling you, it can work better when you're at home, if you can believe it or not. I mean, I've really, especially doing the 30-day tennis technique and fitness challenge, more people have improved at home than they have, you know, on the court. Then we're doing a 7-day picture perfect challenge, which basically is the art of tennis, showing you all the different fundamental moves, like you were basically going to a karate class on all the strokes that you can send me. And then we're going to do a 7-day fitness and weight loss challenge because like you, I have been going off the rails. Me and my girlfriend have been going out. I've been a bad boy. So I'm going to, starting tomorrow, because I'm going to start filming tomorrow, I'm going to shut it down and I'm going to go to Boersville and start eating better and start doing the fitness. So the fitness videos will be there and I'm going to have like confessionals, like Pete confessionals, you know, like if I didn't do what I ate and if I did do well, what I ate.
Nice.
And,
accountability.
So it's going to be, yeah, it's three challenges in one. And you know, to send in a video is super easy. Watch how easy this is. You see, if I want to reply to Mendy here, which I'm going to, watch how easy the communication is back and forth. Okay. So you can do this on your phone, on your computer. It's super easy. So don't tell me you can't do this. Can you just click reply and have a camera come up? And are you smart enough to click this red button where it says hit record to start? Because there was one email I got from a lady. She's like, I'm a little old and I'm afraid to send a video. I have to get up the courage to send a video. Can anybody do what I just did? And then you hit record. It counts you down 3, 2, 1. And Mendy, I just want to make this video for you to let you know how proud I am of you. And yes, you know, I'm sure you're going to get that elbow move down. So thank you for responding. And I know that you're going to get it. So you're doing a great job. Done. Do I like it? Yeah. Yes.
Oh, did you want to screen share, Pete, or no?
Oh my God. I did all that without screen sharing?
I think.
Oh no. Yes, I do want to do a screen
share. You can do it again.
Okay. I am not the smartest cowboy in town.
It's okay.
Technology's
tough.
Technology. I'm just saying how easy it is, and then I totally screw up the whole presentation. Okay. So let me come over here first of all. This is the Tennis Terminator Challenge. Okay, it's three challenges rolled into one. Maribon's going to give you the link where you can try 3 days for free. We're doing a 7-day upgrade your backhand challenge, a 7-day picture perfect challenge, and a 14-day weight loss challenge. Also, if you want to unlock all of our challenges, like if you're any good at math, you can see that this is the way to go. That the three challenges in one are $67. Okay. The yearly pass is just $99. Okay. So you will be charged annually $99, but you get to be in all our challenges, and you don't have to keep re-upping for the challenges. So look what we're doing. You'll get all the past challenges, 30-day tennis technique and fitness challenge, the 7-day backhand challenge for getting ready to go into, 4-day upgrade your forehand challenge, 4-day upgrade your backhand volley challenge, 7-day double shot specialty challenge, 7-day mixology challenge, which is basically like learning how to underspin, topspin, and flat, and be able to really like be that totally confusing, frustrating opponent at your club that everybody hates to play. 7-day picture perfect challenge, 7-day double backhand challenge, which we're getting ready to go into. We're doing a 14-day weight loss challenge. We're getting ready to go into that 7-day weight loss challenge. We might do another one. 7-day accuracy challenge, a 7-day power generator challenge, and a 7-day consistency challenge. Okay. So that's what we're doing over the next 12 months. And if you go $99, you get them all. And we just keep going. Cause again, this is a journey. It's not a destination. Rick, that's a Rick Macyism. And people are like intimidated by technology. What I was showing before on the screen. So Maribon, you can see this pretty well.
Yeah.
All you got to do is hit reply. Look at that. When you start going, when you go on your phone, there'll just be a button where it's like, you just like hit the red button. You just bring it up. And all I got to do is hit this red button to hit start to record. And I'm just going to tell her right here. So she knows. Hey Mendy, I'm back again. We're actually doing a presentation. I just wanted to show people how this app works, and I've been talking about how amazing you've been doing, showing how great a student you are. So I hope you don't mind that. And I just want to encourage you to keep on going. Okay. So you're doing awesome. And I'm going to stop the video right here by hitting the square.
There you go.
I'm back again. Do I like it? Send reply. Boom. That's it.
Easy.
It's easy peasy.
Oh, Jamie had a quick question. She must be very fit. She said, what if I don't need to lose weight? I think she was referring to your weight loss challenge.
Yeah, if you don't need to lose weight, that's 100% fine. But what we're doing with our 14-day fitness challenge is we are doing a lot of tennis-specific workouts. So my workouts are fun, and they are specifically, again, working on the art of tennis. So even though there's some great videos out there that show like maybe some good exercises that are good for tennis players, you know what I mean? Like lunges and things like that, which we'll be intermixing with it too. All my workouts are going to include stroking the tennis ball, like working on the art of tennis. Okay. So it's like tennis yoga, but faster. Like we're going to be, and sometimes we'll be going through the swing super slow, and other times we'll be picking up to like game pace, but I want you to be aware of your movements. Okay. So yeah, so even if you're like in great shape, you'll be still working on the art of tennis every day in this 14-day challenge. Okay.
Yeah, it's just incredible that you know, you're providing like this personal analyzation of people's videos and responding. I think that's so cool. And I don't really see that. I don't think I've seen that from other coaches. So kudos, man.
Well, I'm a little bit crazy.
Yeah. I mean, how many challenges do you have by now, Pete? It's just, wow. I mean, it's crazy.
Well, I've done challenges in the past, but this year I've really started the challenge thing. And so we've done a serve challenge, 7-day serve challenge, 7-day forehand challenge. And then we've done a 30-day tennis technique and fitness challenge. But, you know, I've really decided to do this because I think it's just the best way to do it, you know? So, yeah. Oh, cool. I like that tennis blow. We need 8 more thumbs down.
Right, yeah, they love us. Tennis blood loves us.
Forget you, tennis blood.
Oh man.
Yeah, awesome.
Much nicer comment here with Stan.
Yeah.
And the man.
Yeah. Good luck to you, tennis blood. Go make your own videos.
Oh man. It's all good.
Let's okay. See. So did you put your link in there?
I did, yeah. So I've been sharing it on YouTube. So I don't know if people have been getting it, but yeah. I don't know. If people haven't been seeing it, just let us know and then we'll put it in there.
Put it in there so I can see it.
Yeah, I sent it to you in the other.
No, you post in the comment. I don't see it.
Just so yeah, because I can only post on the YouTube chat.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I've been putting it there.
Okay. Well, cool.
Yeah.
Well, if anybody does not know how to get it, you know, Maribon, I'm sure, will follow up with an email or something and just make sure you get it because it's really good. And I've been having a lot of fun. And a lot of the videos that you saw today were people who are just starting off. They've never sent a video in and they're really liking it. There's one guy, Steven Shapiro, who was, he said he was skeptical and he sent me a video of his serve. And then after that, he's like, thanks a lot. I learned so much. Let me see if I can even find him in this here. And he wrote me a longer email too. Let's see this. So this guy was skeptical. This guy, thanks for the review. Great tips. Okay. So you can see just in a day how much we've already talked. He's like, I'm looking forward to this, lifelong player. I'm a bit skeptical if you can help, but I'm willing to work hard. Okay. And then thanks so much for your quick reply. I sent 4 videos of my serve. Don't do this, by the way. I said, I'm giving you a pass, but I need it to stay in the video ask app. Okay. You guys can't see what I'm talking about, but anyway, thanks for the great review. Great tips. So it's working already for people.
Sweet. That's awesome, Pete. Let's see. Yeah, it seems like some people aren't getting it. So I'll definitely follow up with an email and everything. Pete, if you see it in your other chat, you can feel free to paste that in if you want, but it's all good either way.
Well, when you try, it says can't post comments to Destinate. Was that you? You like it said you couldn't post a comment?
Yeah, it might have been me, but that's weird.
I think if you get a bit.ly link, that would probably work.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, either one.
Okay.
But yeah, it's all good. But Pete, let's see. I mean, what action steps would you want people to take to you know, especially for people who are struggling, like maybe they've built up many years of incorrect technique. Like, what's the first? And is it also like, is it a mindset thing, the first step, or is it like a physical thing? Like, what's the first step for people to take?
Okay, I wrote this down because I taught myself this today. Okay. Because I'm doing something scary, okay? I'm starting an online summer camp with Pete, and I've determined that the best way to get people to sign up is to do some paid advertising, all right? Because a lot of people on our list, we've sent it out, a lot of people on our list, their kids are out. They're empty nesters, and they're into their game. So we're getting some signups, but not enough to really make a dent in this. So I've been throwing, you know, I just have been trying a lot of ideas, and I am doing a YouTube and Google ads right now, okay? It is costing me $54 a lead.
Wow.
That scares the crap out of me.
That's, yeah, dang.
I'm paying the instructors for their videos without us having anybody signed up and paid yet. I'm doing a lot of things that scare me. I'm out of my comfort zone, okay? And I also have started to run ads in like parent magazines and parent like parent programs that have email lists. Now we're starting to get a good amount of leads. That's like a big win. Okay. But that cost me about $2,000. So why am I telling you guys this? Because I've tried ads before and I always run into a corner and under a shell and give up, but I've determined I'm not going to do it this time because I listened to one of my mentors and he was talking about that they can run ads for you. And he's like, at first, you know, here's the process, guys. This is because he's a really good teacher. He's like, first, we're going to run some ads for you and we're going to scare the crap out of you. And you're going to think that this isn't going to work, you know, but then we're going to optimize the ads and their costs are going to go down and everything's going to be good. And it reminded me of a Tiger Woods story. And then I started to think about so many great champions and what they're willing to do to get better. And so Tiger Woods was on top of the world. And then I remember, and I'm not a big golf enthusiast, but I followed Tiger Woods pretty closely when it came on. And he started to lose. Like, he was on top of the world and he started to lose. And he said, and he was like calm, so calm. He's like, it's okay because I'm working on a new swing. and it's coming along. And once it comes, I'm going to be even better. So I remember that lesson this morning when I started to freak out. And I said to myself, Pete, you have to regress in order to progress. And so I think the first thing that if you want to be good, there's no way you can go from doing a frying pan grip and getting the serve in on your second serve 90% of the time and then go out the next day and go with this grip and get it in 90% of the time. You're going to go backwards. You might take, it might not even be two steps backwards. You're going to take like 5 or 6 or 10 steps backwards. So you've got to be willing to regress to progress. And this is what people who accomplish greatness are able to do. They're able to say, okay, my ego can handle the hit. My pocketbook can handle the hit. Like I can deal with this because I see a long-term goal. And so for the people on this call who want to do this, you're going to have to take a step back, do things that you're not used to doing. Another great thing that I learned from a quarterback at the University of Georgia, he got into the mortgage business when I was in the mortgage business, like, I don't know, over 10 years ago. And he said, you want to know the secret to success? It's get comfortable being uncomfortable. He's like, if you're comfortable every day, you're not going to achieve greatness. He's like, you have to be willing to get uncomfortable. And the more that you get yourself in uncomfortable situations, the more successful you'll be in life. All right, I'm done on my soapbox, Maravon.
No, I mean, 100%. You know, I think even though it maybe a lot of you think like, oh, I already know this stuff, it's really important to reiterate, you know, this type of attitude and, you know, mindset and approach is everything. And really just keeping your passion for improving every day and following the correct path and really getting mentored by such, you know, the best people that you can find. That's something that's been my mission is to connect with the best people, the best coaches and experts on the planet in tennis to help everybody and myself, of course, to improve, you know, and keep improving. So that's why I bring people like Pete on. And yeah, I mean, if you have an opportunity like this to send in your video to Pete and for him to give you his personal feedback, I mean, you know, I think it was it USTA Georgia Pro of the Year, Pete, or was it USPTA?
No, USTA Georgia Pro of the Year.
Yeah.
And one thing that was kind of cool about that story is a mentor of mine who taught me a lot about success. He talked about a strategic objective. I'd never done this before in my life. And he's like, okay, I want you to write a strategic objective. And the way you're going to write it is it's a year from now. So you write everything as if you're looking back, as if it's already happened. And he told me, and I'm telling you guys, I had zero students at the beginning of the year. I thought, I am freaking crazy. What am I doing with my life? Okay, that's what I thought. And he put down as a goal for me, it's 2012, I think, or something like that, and you're the USTA Georgia Pro of the Year. He gave me that one. And when I was writing it down, I'm like, I didn't really believe it. I'm like, okay, whatever. Like, no one even knows who. I haven't even taught tennis in the state yet. Like, came around, I was USTA Georgia Pro of the Year. And the reason why that happened is we made goals. We're like, okay, you gotta go here and volunteer here. You gotta do this. You gotta do that. You know, you gotta go above and beyond in your community. And that's what we did. We built up a good program. And I was the USTA Georgia Pro of the Year. It was crazy.
It's amazing, man. That's amazing. Wow. I'm trying to think what else, what other question. What is one of the best pieces of advice that you have ever gotten from a coach or mentor or somebody that relates to developing technique?
Well, I remember that my coach, Ian Griffiths from Australia, that's when I really started to develop very, very good volley technique. And he would always make me freeze after I hit the shot, especially on the volley. So the way it would work, I was a certain volleyer. So imagine I'm running to the net, but the drill we did all the time, every practice. Because again, here's another great line that I've been preaching lately. Bruce Lee says, I respect the man, right, who's practiced one kick 10,000 times over the man who's practiced 10,000 kicks one time. Okay. So taking that into consideration, here was our 10,000 kick practice every time, every private lesson I ever had with him. Serve, come on in, hit a volley to the box in the backhand corner, had to make it in the box to score a point. We tried to, we always measured how many we could make out of 10, and I would freeze on the target. And if I didn't freeze, there was hell to pay, right? And if I broke my wrist like that, which a lot of people do on the backhand volley, I couldn't then just go, oh man, and walk away. If I broke my wrist, I'd have to correct it. So we're building in that muscle memory all the time, right? And if I just volleyed it and walked away like that, I got an earful. If I volleyed, we had certain spots we had to hit based on where he returned it and where I served it. And if I didn't hit the right spots, he would always ask me, why did you do that, mate? And I'd be like, I don't know, Ian. And he'd be like, because you're a bloody moron. That's why.
Oh, my God.
And then I would inevitably do it again like 2 minutes later. And he'd say, Freeman, why did you do that? And I'd be like, because I'm a moron. He'd be like, exactly, mate. You're learning.
Oh, my gosh. Wow. So if you don't have access to a coach or somebody who can like provide that accountability, what are some other ways that you can get accountability to help you improve?
I'm sorry, what was that exact question?
Sure. Basically, like, what are some other sources of accountability if, say, you don't have a coach like you had who's, you know, constantly looking and holding you accountable?
Okay. Well, if you decide that you want to go it completely alone and you don't want me to analyze your videos, which you're kind of crazy if you don't.
Yeah, it is.
You got to at least do this. You have to at least get out your phone and you've got to start learning about what you really look like. You have to get comfortable being uncomfortable. It might be a little uncomfortable to look and go, oh, I guess I don't look like Roger Federer. Like, I'm far from Roger Federer. That's okay. See, so you have to be willing to get out that camera phone and start to study yourself. And I would do lots of, before even my process that I recommend for you is to do this off the court. Because what I'm going to show you right here, right? It's amazing how many people cannot do that correctly. Don't assume that you can do it 100% correctly. Most, and now that people are sending me videos, I've stayed more videos than I ever had in the last 3 months. I see that there's virtually no one that sends in a video that I can't help them, that I can't point out some things that can get better. And this is where I want you to see the opportunity. Like, let's say you're like, well, I got just terrible strokes. I didn't want to look at it. Look at it the other way. Go, there's so much I can improve. Like, someone who is way overweight, they can lose a lot more weight faster than somebody who's really fit. Like, look at it that way. Look at, like, you know, it. I can drop this weight really quick because I'm way out of shape, so it's going to be easier for me to drop weight. That actually is, you know, like, you can drop weight faster than somebody who is, like, fit and maybe, you know, starts to get a little skinny fat or whatever. Then it's harder for them. So you actually can improve a lot in a short amount of time, the more things you actually have wrong. So in a way, it's actually could be better for you, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure, Pete. So we have a pretty interesting question from Chris Martin Tennis, who says, what would you say is the best advice you've received or given when developing a solid athletic foundation? I think technicals are overly emphasized. You know, I think that, you know, all aspects of tennis are really important. Obviously, you know, if you're not fit enough, you're going to lose. If you don't have good enough technique, you're going to lose movement, etc. I mean, just as far as athletic foundation, I think something that helps a lot is playing a lot of different sports to develop, you know, different skills, like especially if you were to play baseball or football. I know actually quite a few pros who I've interviewed on my podcast, the Tennis Files podcast, and they have great serves. And when I asked them, you know, what did you do when you were a kid? They said, oh, I played baseball, I played football. So, I mean, that's one general thing, is to try other sports as well. But what's your take on this, Pete?
Well, I think too, as far as like he said, I think he said technique is a little overrated. Is that what he said?
Yeah, essentially overemphasized.
Overemphasized. Okay. And so I think it's all on how you, what you want out of it. I agree 100%. If you see, the thing is I don't think most people are on this call to bat the ball around. Okay. I think most people want to become artists on the tennis court. Because you don't need to be watching online instruction if you want to start to win right away at 3-0 or 3-5. Okay. Because the people who win at 3-0 or 3-5, lots of them are really good athletes, have really good hand-eye coordination and zero technique. And their life is actually a lot easier than the starving artist that comes online to learn how to play tennis, which is what you guys are, okay? Because, you know, the easiest way to start to dominate is to simplify everything. Like if I was to say, okay, we've got 30 days, you don't really have much technique, but you're gonna play a 3-0 tournament and we're gonna teach you how to win it. I'd get you in great shape, and I would take everything away. I wouldn't teach you how to stroke the ball. I'd teach you how to poke the ball. I'd be like, we're going to be awesome from here to here. And then we could just put the ball down the line, put the ball cross court, lob over their head. Like if I got really good at doing this, like I'm telling you, I could go out and only be allowed to do this and not lose at 3-5. Because I've got this contact awareness, and I could just hit a little drop shot, lob over your head. Like, so if you want to get really good, really fast, get great here. Get great at the contact point and take away all this stuff trying to look like Roger Federer. But if I went out there and I tried to do this against a 4-5 player, I could not beat them. I would lose 6-0. I would lose 6-0. So yeah. If you have aspirations, if you're like, no, I want to be an artist, then that's where technique does become important. Because if you want to be able to take a full swing at a ball and it still go in, the technique must be perfect. There is no compromising. The faster the racket head speed goes and the bigger the backswing is, the technique must be flawless or else you are going to be frustrated.
Yeah. Oh, Pete, there was a question from Ben about the contact angle, because he said that he noticed that when you were demonstrating the ideal contact point, that the racket was actually closed. So do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, exactly. You're going to see lots of pictures of Federer hitting a ball and his racket's almost like this, you see, but he's coming beneath and up. See, that's going to go in. See that? Cause I'm coming low and up on it.
Right. Okay?
And I can even take a high ball if I'm close into the net and I can hit and be here at contact. If I'm like, if I can see blue on the other side of the court, if I can see the court over the net, I can actually just swing down on the ball like that and it goes in. So yep. You have to have that racket head awareness. So you're going to see lots of videos to where the racket face is like there, but they're coming up and they're doing that. So it's got a chance to go in. And or you're going to see the contact like that or like that. But once it starts to go like that, it's out.
Yeah. Yeah. Good question from Francois, who I like that name as well. Is there a set start time per session or is it personal?
No, here's the way it's going to work. You're going to get lessons of the day. So you're going to get, some days you're going to get a picture perfect backhand volley and a workout. Okay. And maybe a Pete confessional. I'm not going to do it every day, but maybe a confessional, like this is what I ate today. And some days will be good and some days will be bad. Actually, tonight's my last bad day. So Maribon, I have to do this.
Oh no. Is it going to be the tub of ice cream again?
No. Look where I went.
Oh my God. You don't know how much I missed that.
Oh, bubble tea, baby. I love bubble tea.
You're brutal, man. First the songs and now this.
So good.
How much sugar do you get in that? Actually, I think
like so much sugar.
Because you can adjust it, right? Like to 50 or like 30 or whatever.
100%.
Jeez.
No, I go 50%.
Okay.
But it's really good. But anyway, tomorrow when I wake up, it's game time. It's like I'm Rocky in training. But that's my goal. You see, I might break. I might tell you I'm not perfect. I'm far from perfect. So even though I'm telling you that's what I do, I might break down and like go get another bubble tea. But hopefully I'll be brave enough to put it on video like, guys, I broke down. So you're going to get a video lesson, a fitness lesson, and then you're going to get a challenge to where you can click on a button, just like I showed you tonight, and send in your video every day. And I critique it every day. I get up in the morning. So if you send me a video like in the morning, I mean, like in the afternoon, you're probably not going to see me respond to like the next day.
Yeah, I mean, it takes a little time with all these hundreds of videos you're getting.
I've been up in the morning doing videos sometimes.
Man, you're committed. And yeah, so with that link, you know, I'm having trouble posting it, I think, but it's basically tennisfiles.com/terminator. But for everybody who has subscribed to my newsletter and everything, I'll send you the link and you'll be good for that. But however you join, I think it's an amazing opportunity to get some fantastic personal you know, feedback from a coach like Pete. So really, really cool stuff there, Pete. And yeah, any other details that people should know about for joining or anything?
I think we just covered. I think the biggest thing though is a sense of a bond. I think what I've enjoyed and why I'm willing to keep doing it, because I'm like, there's been parts of me like, it's so much easier to just like promote it, put out the videos, move on with life. Like, that's a lot easier.
Right.
But like, you see Brad here and Brad and his wife. I mean, Brad made his own graduation ceremony. Brad and I are
incredible.
Brad and I are now friends. Like, I think we're legit friends because we build a relationship. We're just chat. Tanya, who was on here, we're buddies. Like, because it goes beyond just the instruction. Once you start batting the ball back and forth every day and communication wise, you start to really know each other. And that's my favorite thing about it is it goes way beyond just getting your package of videos to just sit there and unfortunately collect internet dust. I mean, I know sometimes you get all excited, you get a course, then you like never log in.
Yeah. So gotta take action.
This is an opportunity to where if you do have fire in the belly to get better and you just try it and you start saying your videos, you're like, oh my God, this is so cool. Like, you know, I mean, to me, it's like, cause I love it and I love my courses that I've made and I put my heart and soul into every course, but sometimes I feel guilty where I'm like, are they getting better though? I don't know, because the videos are just laying there. And then you get some emails like, oh, your course really helped me. But when it goes this way, I feel like, okay, I don't feel guilty at all. I'm like, if you guys don't send the video, it's on you. I'm like, I'm here. I'm going to battle every day with you. I am in the trenches with you every day. If you want to come join me and fight, but if you don't send in your videos, then I no longer feel guilty. I feel like you guys are getting like 10 times worth your money doing this. That's yeah. What I feel.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. Oh, thank you, Chris. I appreciate that. Very nice of you. Tanya. Yeah. I mean, yeah, there's no restrictions here, but pretty much. So it's really great. I'm trying to see if there's any other questions over here. Can I do preview sessions if I miss them? Do you know what that means, Pete?
Yeah, once you get your challenges, they live there forever.
Cool. Yeah.
You cool. Always awesome. Get daytime access to the course. So it's not like the day goes away.
Yeah, yeah. Awesome. Yeah, trying to think what else, Pete. I mean, you got any closing thoughts on technique development as a whole, and how, you know, any wise words of wisdoms in that regard for technique to improve it?
One last word of wisdom from the great Rod Laver. I was interviewing him, and I was talking about, well, you know, how do you become a pro? Like, how do you get good enough to become a pro? And he said, well, you can't skip steps. That's what he said. It's like, you can't skip steps when we all want to skip steps, you know, especially I taught so many players who have good technique and they lose at 3-0 and they're going to be great players. I can tell they're going to be 4-0 someday. But one of the things that they do as a mistake, they're like, well, I want to go play with the 3-5s and 4-0s. It's so much more fun. And they can hit with them, but they're not, their mind isn't developed. They're not able to win against people who are worse than them and things like that. They're not able to problem solve. So you can't go 3-5 to 4-0 if you're losing the 3-0s. And a lot of people just want to do that because the balls hit to them better. It's more predictable. They have more fun. If they lose, they're like, oh, well, I lost to somebody who's a 3-5, 4-0, and they said I'm really good for a 3-0. Like, these are the things that happen. Where I believe that to get to be the best player you can, you don't skip steps. You do your shadow swings. You get expert coaching, right? You study yourself. Then you go out and you practice on the court with a tennis ball. Then you do it in a rally. Then you do it in a match. Then you just rinse and repeat over and over and over again. You keep going back to the drawing board. You can't skip steps. And then, like, as far as like wanting to go from a 3-0 to a 3-5 and a 4-0, you can't skip steps there either. You know, I mean, one of the biggest mistakes I think juniors make is like they start to get kind of good and they're like, oh, yeah, we're going to start playing them up in the 14s. Like, yeah, but you're like number 50 in the state in the 12 and unders. Like,
yeah.
Go play in the 14s until you're freaking number one, beating everybody 0-0 in the 12 and unders. It's a joke what happens.
Yeah.
And you got to view this as a video game. It's like you're not going to be able to play Mario Brothers and go to the next level until you beat the first level. And that's how you're going to get the best, where you get through the first level like this every time, easy. Now you go to the next level. Now you deserve to be at the next level. Same thing with tennis.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, some of that comes from really fear of losing, I think, to some degree, you know, where the players, like, they say, oh, I'm going to play up already, but you can't, you know, you're not even beating players in your own division or age group. So, yeah.
That's one of the biggest mistakes tennis players make, is they keep looking at these levels and they want a ranking behind them to validate what they're doing and where they think they should be ego-wise. But don't worry about the levels. The levels will take care of themselves. Worry about the process. Focus on the process, and it was going to take care of itself. And don't. And if you're doing most of the steps and not all the steps, you're still going to be frustrated, because you're going to be like, I'm doing more than that person. I have better technique than that person. But the reason why you're not blowing by them faster is you're still skipping some steps. The programs I'm doing is allowing you not to skip steps. Like, I'm going to make you send me shadow strokes. And until that shadow stroke is perfect, you're not going on the tennis court to hit a tennis ball. Because if you can't do it perfect without a ball, then how are you going to do it perfect with a ball? And I've heard some novice players tell me, like, well, I can't do it without a ball. I need to hit a ball. Like, well, yeah, but your technique is no good at all. Like, you don't need to hit a ball. Just because you can hit the ball in, if you want to be an artist, you can't hit a ball. Yes, you can go out there and hit a ball, but you're poking the ball around. You're slapping it around. You're not creating art. You're not molding art. That's what I always like to consider. When I take a student, I look at each student as moldable art. Because when tennis is done, and I'm not saying it's done at the highest level like Roger Federer, when tennis is done right, whether you're 10 years old, 20 years old, 50 years old, when tennis is done right, it's beautiful to watch. And I want all my students to stick with me long enough to look beautiful. I want you to look beautiful if that's what you want. Now, if you just want to win, I'm fine with that too. And then we can just talk about poking the ball around the court and beating player B across the court who's just at your level. And we can figure out how to beat them just like by strategy. That's fine too. But I don't think most people are online to learn how to pat the ball around and win.
That's right.
If you are, that's cool too. Nothing wrong.
Add to the toolkit, keep improving, improving your technique. I mean, it also just feels so good. I mean, to work through some subpar technique, get it down, and then be able to hit a nice crisp ball with really good looking technique. I mean, I think, you know, that's something that a lot of us aspire to doing. And you can be on your way with, you know, a lot of this free, amazing content that Pete provides, as well as his premium content as well. I mean, it's all premium really, but really love what you're doing, Pete. And I mean, just again, like, I have to really applaud you for the so many hours that you're putting into personally responding to people. And I mean, people, the instructors like this, like, I actually have seen websites where they're charging like, you know, $500 for like for watching a video clip of somebody and then giving them feedback. So I just want to let everybody know that you really definitely want to join. You go to tennisfiles.com/terminator just join the program. It's really amazing. So thank you, Pete, for providing this.
Thank you. It's been a lot of fun. Happy Mother's Day to all the moms out there. My mom, it's great. We just got a puppy. Oh my gosh.
So terrible. Cool.
Have I shown you the puppy? Have you seen the puppy online?
I think so, but you should show the people, I think. If you want.
Oh my God. This puppy is just so awesome. We lost our dog Barkley a while back. And so we just got a puppy and he is just awesome. So this is a great way to work. Let me know when it comes into view. Can you see it yet?
Yeah, I could see it. Yeah. Wow. So cute.
Look at him. He's awesome. So Happy Mother's Day to my mom. Happy Mother's Day to all your moms. Maribon, happy Mother's Day to your mom.
You too. Thanks so much. Happy Mother's Day to all the important women in your life and in everybody's lives. And definitely grateful for all of you. And I just really had a lot of fun with you today, Pete. And thanks again for what you're doing. And I'm sure we'll be doing more of these streams. It seems like it's mostly popular with everybody, except for a few.
Yeah.
But
Tennis Blood. I'm coming after you, Tennis Blood.
Tennis Blood and Mike. My gosh. But you know what? You know, since he said those to equalize or whatever, we got just all likes. So now we're up to 24-2. So that's great.
Good.
Oh, man. Well, yeah. I don't know what else to say except everybody definitely go check out the challenge here. And all of Pete's challenges are amazing. You can go to tennisfiles.com/terminator. And I'll email you all the link as well because I can tell who clicked on the link to join this. So
wait, before we go, I got to do some fun. I got to do some fun. Watch this, Maribon.
Yeah.
See, this is how slow Peter is. He's really not the smartest guy. Thank God I can teach tennis. That's all I got to say. I mean, really.
That's okay. I mean, not everyone's great with tech, you know?
It's not even tech. It's just not thinking on the ball. I know how to do it. Watch this. Watch this, guys. If you're wondering how to get the 3 days, there you go.
There you go, guys.
Go to tennisfiles.com/terminator. Write that down. Take a screenshot with your phone because we're about to leave soon. But this is how you can go get 3 free days. And then next Monday, we're going into the 14-day challenge. And I'm calling it the Terminator Challenge because we want to be like a freaking machine. Like, that's why I came up with the Terminator. Like, everybody wants to be a Terminator. You go out to the court, you just demolish the competition. Yeah. Right. It's a cool picture. It's a cool picture of Andy Murray, too, like as a Terminator. But yeah, we want to go out there. We want to feel like we're on autopilot. We're just rocking the ball. If the match is going to go 4 hours, we don't care. We're ready for that. We're like freaking like Rafael Nadal is a Terminator. Like, I want to be like Rafa, you know?
Yeah, so he's a beast.
That's why I came up with it, because we're going to be getting our fitness on point. We're going to be getting our technique on point. It's you're just going to feel awesome after it.
Yeah, very cool stuff. And you know, you were the community as well of other people like you, passionate players. So Chris is asking, and I replied yes, but you're on Instagram as well, right, Pete?
I am on Instagram.
Crunch Time Coaching?
Crunch Time Coaching.
Yeah.
Instagram, posting awesome. Every day.
Yep. And I'm tennis.files because somebody took tennis files, but that's fine. Oh, man. Well, thank you, everybody. Thank you, Marcia, Francois, Chris, Brian, Jamie, everybody. Thank you so much. Howard, Brad. Yeah, just everybody.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
And we all know Maribon's the original tennis files. I don't care if it's dot files. He's the original tennis files.
That's right. Even if they took it first, I am the original.
Yeah, definitely check out his podcast and everything. Maribon is like endlessly putting together awesome content for everybody.
You're my idol, Pete. You're the one. So, I know we're dragging on the goodbyes, and we just love staying on. But I guess I'll finalize it.
Congratulations, by the way, on getting your first win at music trivia.
Yeah, thank you so much, Pete. Somebody already emailed me and said congrats. But yeah, thank you, and I hope to rack it up.
Oh, wait, I cannot leave yet. I cannot leave.
Okay.
Okay. So I got to go to Google here. People today, I said Maribon and I, and I was asking my girlfriend, and is it, wait. Katie and I, or Katie and me? What do you think it is, Maribon?
I think it's Katie and I.
Okay. So, because I had people emailing me today, I asked my girlfriend when I was writing the email title, is it me or I, or how do you do it? And she would say, well, it's Maribon and I. And then so I had people email me today and they were saying, Pete, you give good tennis lessons, but let me give you a grammar lesson. It could be Maribon and me.
Damn.
Now, I'm not smart enough to know they are right or wrong. So I just wrote him back, said, oh, thank you. But then I asked my girlfriend and she's like, no, it would be Maribon and I. And I said, okay. She's like, well, look it up on Google.
Yeah.
It says, if you're talking about a compound subject as opposed to the object, the correct phrase is Katie and I, or Kathy and I is what it says. Kathy and I told them is the example. If me is used as a subject, it really doesn't matter which way you decide to be wrong. So there you go. All the people to correct me, I was right and you were wrong.
Dang it. Pete and me are cool.
Yeah.
Oh. All right. Well, that's amazing, Pete. I'm gonna study my grammar. I should have known that, but
you were right.
Oh yeah, I was right. Yeah. But I'll keep studying my grammar because these are some tricky situations. Like I wasn't actually sure.
I wasn't sure either. And that's why I'm with my girlfriend, and I know she's really smart. She's a doctor and she like has a photographic memory. She's like, she knows everything. And so she said, no, it'd be Maribon and I. And so I okay, I'm writing that. Then people started writing me emails like, no, it's not. Mm. Google told us. Google doesn't lie.
Grammar police. Yeah. Well, oh, I love this. So everybody, I just want you to check out the link, tennisfiles.com/terminator, and you'll get some free, amazing personal training from Pete. And I definitely would highly encourage you to check it out. You have zero to lose. So I definitely want to do that. And thank you again for attending and for learning grammar as well as tennis with us. And we will see you. Yeah, it happens. I mean, but we will all see you very soon, I'm sure, Pete. And thanks again for everything you're doing.
See you guys. Awesome broadcast today.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody. Take care. Be safe.